Welcome to Get Sleepy, the podcast where we listen, we relax, and we get sleepy. As always, I'm your host, Thomas. Thank you for joining me here. Tonight, I'll be reading you a sleepy retelling of one of Aesop's fables. It's the story of a thirsty crow and her ingenious solution. It's a lesson in the importance of persistence and creative thinking. The moral of the story might just be, where there's a will, there's a way. So now, make sure you're nice and comfortable as you prepare for a great night's rest. Close your eyes if you haven't already done so, and take some deep, nourishing breaths, breathing in through the nose and out through the nose or mouth. As you do, try to feel each moment of the breath, the air flowing in through your nostrils, traveling down into your lungs and expanding the muscles in your chest and stomach, then easing back out through your nose or mouth, releasing those muscles so that they can rest between each inhale. With every breath, you distance yourself further from the energies and actions of the day, inviting a sense of relaxation. There are no more responsibilities to be dealt with today. Your body is already resting comfortably in bed. And so too can your mind. So, take one more deep breath in and slowly exhale back out and relax. As you move along the path to sleep tonight, just follow the sound of my voice. You may drift in and out of the story, and that's okay. There's no need to hear every word. You can always come back later to hear it again if you'd like. Our story tonight begins high on a cliff overlooking the sea. A young hooded crow perched softly in her nest. She was elegant, with glossy black wings and a black head and beak. The rest of her body was covered in grey feathers. Her back was a dark storm cloud grey, and she had a soft pale grey on her belly. When her feathers caught the sunlight, they occasionally flashed silver and green. This crow lived a long, long time ago. She built her nest on the edge of a golden cliff, overlooking the crystalline blue waters of the sea. She spent her days soaring over the beach, searching for bits of seaweed to to add to her nest. Or she chattered with the neighbouring birds, who made their homes in the different nooks and crannies along the cliff. It was a beautiful, peaceful existence. There was food and water in abundance, and nothing she had to fear. She lived the life she had always known, with the sun and the sea, and the long, lazy days of what felt like eternal summer. But one day, she became aware of a change in the environment. Sitting in her nest, she noticed a subtle shift in the sea air. It was cooler than before, no longer the soft, refreshing summer breeze, but a wind that felt almost cold. The crow shivered in her nest and buried herself in a blanket of moss. The summer was all she had ever known. Now that cooler weather was arriving, she would have to find another place to nest, at least for the next season. She would then come back to the coast the following year for another glorious summer. After tidying up her nest, the crow took flight. She soared up into the air and took one final lingering look at the sea. Then, with a sigh, she turned her back to the waves and let the wind carry her south across the land. Although she felt wistful at the thought of the beauty she was leaving behind, she knew in her heart it was time for a change. She was young and curious, and ready for a new adventure. Perhaps she would find strange exotic trees, unlike anything she had ever seen before, and lands even more wild and beautiful than her dreams. As she sailed over the dusty earth and golden fields, the crow daydreamed of the places that awaited her. She imagined tall green trees with twisting, spiraling branches, so many of them that they seemed as infinite as the stars. She pictured vast lakes that mirrored the sky, and snow-capped mountains lining the horizon. And she saw herself in all these magical landscapes, soaring and diving through the air. As she travelled, she would collect all the beautiful things she found, like feathers, twigs, and flowers. She would use them to create a new nest. It would be a cozy home for the winter months, and a work of art that she could be proud of. The land beneath her looked like a patchwork quilt. Yellow squares of wheat stood next to green fields. These were sometimes divided in the middle by long, straight paths where people and horses travelled. The land was mostly flat, but she could sometimes detect a rising slope or hill, like a ripple in the fabric of the earth. As she moved further inland, there was more variation. The land went up and down in waves, and the trees became greener and denser, From above, these vast canopies looked inviting. They were the perfect place to build a nest. She could choose any one of these branches and make it her home. But it was too early to interrupt her journey. She was settling into a comfortable rhythm, enjoying the warmth of the sun on her wings and the sight of the ever-changing ground beneath her. She would fly further south. After soaring over the forest, the crow began to follow a winding river. It was a shining streak of blue that curved its way past fields and trees, towns and cities. The sight of water was comforting, as it reminded her of the view she had left behind, on the cliff overlooking the ocean. This river was a different shade of blue. It was lighter and more transparent. It moved differently too, flowing slowly but purposefully onwards, creating a path for itself across the land. The ocean waves would roll towards the shore, over and over again, advancing and then retreating. The land and the ocean were two separate worlds. But this river moved through the earth, living right in the middle of the woods and the hills. She found herself entranced by the river's beauty and fascinated by the life surrounding it. She saw wild horses drinking from the sloping banks, and young men splashing in the shallows. There were small wooden boats too, carried along by the currents. Some of the boats were piled high with boxes, and one was even being used to transport furniture. The crow saw a table, some chairs and cooking pots all tied together and held in place at the back of the boat. It looked as though someone was moving house and taking their belongings with them. But for the crow, it was far easier to leave everything behind and start afresh. She was looking forward to creating her new home and decorating it with the treasures she found along the way. It was a chance to change, and it meant that she could travel easily with nothing weighing her down. She was completely free. The sun was beginning to set, casting a golden glow over the river. The crow flew down to the river's edge to drink, sipping some of the clean, fresh water. Then she decided to find a place to rest for the night, so she could sleep for a while before continuing her journey south. She had never flown for so long without stopping, and she could feel the tiredness spreading right through her, from her head down to the tips of her wings. Next to the river was a small grove of trees, including an ancient olive tree. It wasn't very tall, but it had a thick, sturdy trunk as wide as a boulder and plenty of branches. A couple of birds had already made themselves at home, and were resting in the upper branches, their green feathers blending into the leaves. The crow flew up into the tree and began to explore, walking from one branch to another until she found the perfect spot. There was a long, straight branch that stretched out in the direction of the river. From here, she could watch the sunset over the water. It was the closest thing to the view from her old nest on the seaside cliff. She perched on a comfortable part of the branch and gazed at the leaves and the golden light on the water. She found it so calming that she drifted into a deep, peaceful sleep before darkness fell. When she awoke the next morning, the sun was already high in the sky. The light danced and sparkled on the surface of the river between the passing boats. The crow decided to continue following the water to see where all the boats were heading. She stretched her wings and took flight, traveling directly above the river and mirroring every bend and curve. She noticed the occasional building near the banks, modest huts and farmhouses. Soon, one house became two, then three, then a whole street. The change was so gradual, she hardly noticed until she found herself right over the rooftops of an enormous city. She had never seen anything like it. From up here, the city was a vast maze, an intricate labyrinth of rooftops, columns, domes, and towers. The roofs of most of the houses were made of red tiles, a color resembling the sky at sunset. Then there were the golden domes, shining as brightly as the sun itself. The rest of the city was like an ocean of white marble, flowing over the land as far as the eye could see. There were even a few trees in between the buildings. As the crow glided over the rooftops, she spotted huge palm trees swaying in the breeze, and a square lined with purple jacarandas. But although it was beautiful, the crow could not imagine herself living here. She could admire it from a distance, but she would have to keep searching for a quieter, greener space. After one last glance over the glimmering rooftops, she slowly flew away from the city towards the countryside in the south. She had now lost sight of the river, but there were always new things to look at. There were orchards, vineyards, and fields where sheep and cattle grazed. It may not have rivaled the splendor of the city, but she felt more at home here. Any of these trees would make the perfect place for a nest. But she wanted to travel just a little bit further to see what lay beyond the horizon. As the day went on, the crow began to feel tired and thirsty. She had left the river far behind, and there was no sign of a lake or pond. So she would have to find another source of water to quench her thirst. She flew down and landed on the roof of a country house directly below her. It was a humble home, surrounded by a vast garden filled with cypress trees and acres of vineyard. Looking closer, she noticed rows of potted plants lined up by the walls of the house. They all looked lush, green, and healthy, even though, from the look of the dusty earth, it had not rained in a while. She couldn't see any water, but it had to be there somewhere, if only she knew where to look. Built into the garden wall was a marble basin with a sculpture of a lion's head at the center. The crow flew over and perched on the edge of the basin. It was damp, but empty. There was a hole in the stone lion's mouth, so it must have been some kind of fountain. But there was no button to press, and no tap to turn. She could cool her feet walking across the damp stone, but she couldn't drink. And in this moment, that was all she could think about, the simple pleasure of a sip of water. She was just about to give up and fly away when she spotted something. In the corner of the garden, almost hidden by the shade of a magnolia tree, was a wooden table. And right there, in the middle of the table, was a large terracotta jug. The crow flew across the garden and landed on the table before hopping up to the edge of the jug. She peered inside and caught a glimpse of her own reflection in the water. At last, she had found something to drink. But the crow's joy quickly turned to disappointment. The jug was only half full, and the neck and opening were narrow. They were large enough for a sparrow to enter, but not a crow. She could see the water, but she couldn't drink it. Her first thought was to push the jug over, but as she tapped it with her beak, she realized that it was far too heavy to move. She would exhaust her strength and make herself even more thirsty in the process. Even if she did succeed in pushing it over, the water would be wasted. It would pour out over the table and onto the ground in a matter of seconds. Then another idea came to her. It was pure inspiration, appearing out of nowhere like a flash of light. If she could not reach the water, she would make the water come to her. Not with force, but with intelligence. There was a small round pebble on the ground near the table. The crow hopped down to pick it up with her beak and then flew back to the rim of the jug. She opened her beak and let the pebble drop into the water. Just as she had hoped, the weight of the pebble made the level of the water rise. The change was almost unnoticeable, but the crow was sure that this was the solution. With a little work and patience, she would finally be able to drink. The search for stones took time. If the pebble was too small, it would hardly make any difference to the water level. And if the pebble was too big, she would struggle to carry it in her beak. She would have to choose each stone carefully, one at a time. As the crow explored the garden and the surrounding fields, she felt herself sliding into a kind of trance. In the soft, dry heat of the late afternoon, her mind cleared. She forgot about her thirst and everything except her quest. It was a relaxing routine, searching in the bushes and secret corners of the garden to find the perfect pebble, and then bringing it back to the jug. Each time she dropped a stone and watched the water rise up ever so slightly, she was filled with a sense of deep satisfaction. And although she soon grew tired, flying back and forth, she was never bored. With each stone and every journey, she found something new to notice and appreciate. Once she was enchanted by a particular part of the garden, a bench in the shade, encircled by wonderfully scented bushes of lavender and thyme. In another moment, it was the colour and shape of the stone that caught her imagination. It lay half hidden in the earth near the vines, and when she pulled it out, she saw that it was a pearly white and as smooth as if it had been shaped by the sea. But as the water in the jug rose higher and higher, it was the act of dropping the stone that gave her the most pleasure. Time seemed to slow down, almost to the point of standing still. She opened her beak to let the pebble fall, and she watched, mesmerized, as it tumbled down. The surface of the water rippled, then slowly became still again. The crow gazed at her reflection and the growing collection of pebbles beneath it, piled up like an underwater mountain. She paused for a moment, feeling happy with her progress and grateful for each and every stone. These were pebbles that others would have passed by without a second thought, but they were invaluable to her. The stones were easy to overlook, but the crow knew that sometimes it was these simple objects that made all the difference. When she built her nest, she often used material that other creatures ignored or discarded, like twigs or pieces of torn fabric. She understood the true value of everything in the world, no matter how ordinary it might appear. By the time the crow dropped the final pebble in the jug, it was dusk. There had once been a patch of shade from the magnolia tree, covering the table. But now, the entire garden was transformed by the evening shadows. The final rays of golden sunlight were visible on the walls of the house, on the far side of the garden. It would soon be night, and time for a deep, restful sleep. But first, she would relish this long-awaited drink. After the final pebble had settled in the jug, the crow leaned down and dipped her beak into the water. It was cool and delicious, and left her feeling refreshed after just a few sips. She imagined she could feel the water spreading right through her body, like a deep breath. Now that she had quenched her thirst, she wanted nothing more than to rest. When she thought of taking flight once more and scanning the countryside for a suitable tree, she felt even more exhausted. She couldn't take to the skies again with such a tired, heavy head and such weary wings. Tomorrow, she would continue her search for a more permanent home, somewhere to build a nest for the coming months. But tonight, she would stay right here. It was safe, quiet, and peaceful, and there was plenty of water to drink the next morning. She gazed down into the jug, admiring the results of her hard work. And then the crow noticed that something else had become visible in the reflection. She could see not only the stones in the water and the mirror image of her head, but also the leaves of the tree above. The magnolia tree that had given her shade would also provide her with a place to sleep. When the wind moved the leaves, she could make out the faint reflection of a crescent moon. From this perspective, the moon looked like part of the magnolia, delicately balanced between the branches. The crow took one last sip from the jug and then fluttered up to the nearest branch. There were no other birds in the tree, and it felt like having a large, comfortable house all to herself. She could hear the sounds of distant birds and the hum of insects, as well as some faraway voices. Perhaps they were coming from inside the country house. But in that moment, it didn't really matter what the sounds were or where they were coming from. When the crow closed her eyes the sounds seem to fade and vanish in an instant. There was no need to pay attention to her surroundings or to think about anything at all. Her body knew just what to do, to settle in to a well-earned rest. Her head drooped down into her chest, and she gently arranged her wings into a comfortable position. And then, after just a few deep breaths, she was fast asleep, cradled by the branch of the magnolia tree.